8198 or visit them online at meridianmarina.com for more details. At Meridian Marina, we do all the work so you can enjoy your boating lifestyle. The ABC's Alliance for Better Community Schools would like to remind you to vote yes for an appointed superintendent on November 6, 2018. Let's hire a professional, not a politician. Visit voteappointed.com for more information. In the studio, we continue our Meet Your Candidate series, and we have the first for District 4 County Commission candidates, and tonight I have Harold Markey in the studio. How are you doing this evening, Harold?
Great, Casey. Thanks so much.
Absolutely. First-time guest. Excited to have you, and so I'll start out a little bit. You had worked 27 years for the county already, and you just couldn't get enough, I guess.
Well, you know, I really enjoyed the years I spent with Martin County, closer to 28, actually, and decided to leave, actually, just for this reason. You know, I could have stayed a couple more years and wrote out my retirement fully, but I decided that I really needed to make a change, and I thought I could do it here.
So you wanted to make a change in what ways? Why are you running?
Well, what really sparked my interest more than anything was, you know, working with the county and general services behind the scenes and fighting year in and year out for funding needs for our facilities and our vehicles and with the challenge of every year with the budget issues. The recent loss of the 1 cent sales tax really upset me. We really desperately needed another funding mechanism this past year. And when we lost that 1 cent sales referendum resoundingly, you know, it kind of sent a message to me. It sent a message that we had kind of lost the public trust, and the public no longer believed that our commission, our board, was going to make responsible decisions in how they were going to spend their money. So I thought it was important for me. I've always been somebody that's been extremely transparent. My department annually would post the costs of our buildings and our vehicles on our public website, you know, so every dollar that we spent was openly advertised for anybody to criticize or talk about or call and talk to me. So I thought it was important that we try and bring some common sense and some compromise. That's something that I think has been missing for a lot of years in Martin County.
It is, and it was a surprising vote. There was a previous vote, I think about a year and a half, maybe 2 years before that, and it was a very close vote. It was defeated by less than 70 votes, as I recall. So when it came back last year and was defeated so resoundingly, it was a huge wake-up call of what voters thought about how the county was spending their taxpayer money. And as you said, there is a huge backlog of expenses that absolutely needs to be taken care of.
Yeah, and that's kind of the platform that I'm riding on. You know, I think other candidates, for the most part, you know, that are running talk about, you know, the water, and obviously that's a huge issue, you know, an issue that we can't resolve ourselves,
right?
For sure. You know, it's going to require us to continue to task our state legislators and federal government to come in and help us with that. You know, the need for to fund SERP, you know, the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Program, is something that's important. It's necessary, but it's a huge amount of money, and certainly we can't afford to do it. So that and the train is another big issue, you know, that people have talked about, you know. But again, the loss of trust and the deferred maintenance issues, which is a scaringly large dollar right now, you know, close to a $500 million that we have, and it didn't happen overnight. You know, this is 30 years of neglect, and it's not just us, it's every other government entity, municipality, state, federal levels. People just don't think and realize how important maintenance, and it's a bad word, I guess, in most people, but I've lived it for 46 years. I've lived in maintenance myself and facilities maintenance, so I think it's important, and people don't realize that the cost of maintenance and life cycle costs are sometimes as great as the capital cost for the asset when you buy it.
Right.
So left unchecked and kicking the can down the road constantly just creates bigger problems, higher costs, and we'll never catch up. You know, I mean,
right.
We can never catch up, but we've got to change the way we're going forward. We've got to start to think of needs as opposed to wants.
That's
right. I think that's critical in government. You know, we all too often are, you know, and we do this in life too, I think. I think in life, you know, we all have wants, you know, in your own home, you have wants. But the reality is if you have a hole in your roof, are you going to put a swimming pool in, you know, and that's the common sense part of it. And unfortunately, we do in Martin County. So
Harold, that's right. It's all about prioritizing. You have been in the audience here at the commission meetings, and certainly see you in there listening to different topics. And one of the topics that has recently been exposed through the Martin County Taxpayer Association, they did a study on Sailfish Splash Park. One of the things that park is looking to do is put in a deep dive pool, about $10 million. Where would you stand on that issue?
I'm firmly against it. You know, I think that, you know, the Splash Park plan, when it first came to us, and I'm sure everybody knows this, but originally it was supposed to be a swimming pool. You know, Martin County School District swimming pool was in disrepair and failing, and the county and the school board had gotten together and decided that they were going to build a combined swimming pool. And that was a great idea when you think about it. You know, I mean, a shared product that both the county could utilize in some way, shape, or form for the rest of the residents, and something the school could use. So all schools, the three high schools, could have used. So I thought it was a great idea. But then the school, I don't know what happened, you know, in the discussion, it turned into a water park. It turned into, you know, what I always call Coney Island. You know, we've got this great, and it's a great asset. I can't tell you it's a great asset. You know, and the staff does a great job of running and operating, and hopefully the people that come there like it. But, you know, it's something that is always going to cost the residents. We are always going to be needing to supplement maintenance operations and costs, and there's no way it can make enough to pay its debt back. And that's one of the problems. Another problem that I struggle with is the county going into business in anything. You know, county government shouldn't be in business. You know, what happens is government operates with a net. You know, as opposed to a business person, you know, if you're a business person and you want to open a restaurant or something, you typically have to lay out the money, the capital cost to build it. Well, in government, the staff doesn't have to do that. The people don't have to do it. The residents do it. You know, they foot the bill. You know, so you're working in government with a net. You know, there's always this constant ability of being able to catch you if you're falling and fund it if you're short.
Right. Right.
And that'll go on forever, and it'll go on for every one of the products that we're talking about, the RV park and Phipps Park. It'll happen at the golf course, which I strongly fought behind the scenes to give back and put another organization in charge, but stay involved and monitor it as opposed to letting it run itself free. It just fell into disrepair. You know, the golf course is a microcosm of the government. You know, the government allowed maintenance to fall behind and neglected it, looking forward to other fun and good things, and the golf course did the same thing. And the golf course, we could have fixed the building, you know, before we tore it down. We didn't. We chose to tear it down. And even now, if the choice, you know, the majority is to keep the golf course, I'm certainly, you know, not against it if that's what we want to do. But I want the public to understand that it's costing you a sizable amount of money. And if you're a taxpayer, do you want to be paying your tax dollars for that? Or do you want your tax dollars to go to needs? Do you want it to go to roads? Do you want it to go to parks repairs instead of new parks? Do you want it to go to maintenance and upkeep on your buildings, your physical buildings? That's what's important to me. What's important to me is needs and not necessarily wants. I understand that the wants are there, and certainly they can be talked about in time, but I think initially, and we're going through a terrible crossroads in the next year, you know, the homestead exemption is coming up, know, next year, and you know that's going to be another loss of revenue for the county. We have no idea what our taxable evaluations values are going to go to next year, and whether we're going to make more money, whether we're going to have more money. So when you look at that giant deferred backlog that'll never be caught up, we need to change our thought process moving forward. We need to think smart. We need to think. We need to think about needs as opposed to wants, and certainly there's some other changes we have to make in our operations. So,
I'm going to run a few topics that are kind of relevant right now that have come up. First one, of course, Indiantown just elected its first council and was incorporated. Hobe Sound will be voting on incorporation later this year. Where do you stand on incorporation of these communities?
Well, you know, I mean, if we could turn the clock back, you know, 10 years, maybe we could have made some changes. We could have done some things differently. I think foolishly what we did is continue to test the public and the business community and you know, insert delays, however that may be interpreted, whether it be our comp plan, you know, issues or whether it be, you know, our staffing shortages that caused delays in people doing things. But inevitably, Indiantown, you know, I guess, felt tired of the constant delays and constant putting off and constant rejection of new growth and new business, no matter what it was. I mean, I think we've gone through these cycles in our years, in my 28 years here in the county for sure, you know, where There's been absolutely no to everything. You know, that's the answer. No, you know, we don't want this, we don't want that. And even when we pass or allow things, you know, we beat people so hard that right. Sometimes they get tired and they just say, I'm not going to build here. It's just too. And there's good and bad to that. You know, the good is, you know, are we sending a message that we're different? Yes, and we are. You know, we are undoubtedly an environmentally sensitive community. I believe that, and I am one too, because, you know, I'm the one that led the county into becoming green certified county, and I've, you know, overseen the only two certified green buildings in the county. So I believe in that concept, but you can't be negligent to the business community and to any growth. You have to be sensible. You have to be reasonable. You have to be able to compromise. And that's something we don't do a very good job of. So I don't blame Indian Town, and I don't blame Hope Sound. You know, Hope Sound is incorporating simply because of the CRA. You know, the last majority board rejected their plan that they had worked on for many years, and, you know, they lost it. So that upset them. You know, sooner or later, you're going to say, well, you know, we'll make our own rules, and we don't need you to tell us how to do things. And I understand that. That's the people speaking, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. But the county's got to wake up and realize that, you know, most of the growth that's happened, we haven't stopped it. You know, the growth down the U.S. 1 corridor has occurred in spite of our wanting to reject it, because they just annex out into the city, and the city has less stringent rules, and they build, and they get the revenue anyway. So we see a lot of that. We've seen a lot of it through the years. So the fight to stop, maybe we've stopped some sprawl, maybe we haven't moved the urban service boundary yet, but it's approaching us, it's coming, and hopefully we do it smart.
Right. There was another topic that came up at the commission meeting about 3 weeks ago, and it's about the Sailfish Marina cell tower. And that, as I understand, is still kind of out there. The commission's still deciding on it. There's staff's overlooking to see if the cell tower is going to, you know, fall into the regulations and rules that the county has for cell towers, and it's at a marina. Do you have any thoughts on that project?
I think it's a big one. You know, it's hard to say one way or the other, but, you know, inevitably I think approval will prevail, unfortunately or fortunately, however people want to think about it, you know. But the reality is, I think there's right to develop, you know, and if it meets our current standards and codes, I don't see where we should be standing against it. You know, it's kind of like the Knight Kiplinger project, you know. I mean, right now, Knight could build, you know, put a lot of homes out there on 5-acre lots with septic systems, and he's chosen not to do that, to do something smarter. So, you know,
Pineland Prairie, but
mm-hmm. he can do what he wants based on the current zoning that he's facing, and the same thing could be said of commercial cell towers. Certainly we'd like them to be better looking.
Yes.
I know.
Yeah, they are what they are. So there's another proposed development that's being spoken about coming up, actually, I think at the next commission meeting, just as a review, and that's the Harmony Ranch proposal. That's going to be a big issue coming up, I think, in this county, because I think there's a graphic coming up here on Facebook Live. It shows that it's out by the high school, South Fork High School,
correct,
other side of the urban service boundary we were just talking about. Where would you fall on that project as a commissioner?
These are the two projects, that and the Pineland Prairie project, the two very, you know, interesting projects. The Pineland Prairie a little bit different than Harmony. Harmony does abut, you know, the urban service boundary line. It's very close. The planning for that, you know, we haven't seen any site development like we have for the Kiplinger project. So who knows whether there'll be cluster development and there'll be preserve areas saved. I think the bigger question in both of these is when is there some methodology that the county has, and I don't know that I've heard that in all of my meetings and listening and reading, you know, as to when, you know, we need to start planning to move the urban service boundary. I know there's been a recent real estate, you know, valuation appraisal done, you know, to determine that we should start talking about it. But is there a scientific method? Because how do you say no to someone and say yes to someone else when in reality they're very similar? Not quite the same, but in some way similar. I listened. I was at both LPA meetings to listen to the presentations and listen to the public. And in a lot of these cases, you hear the public, the public complaining about a development coming next to it, when in reality, when their development was built, there was nothing there before. So inevitably, there's going to be change, you know, and how that change happens, I think, is a very difficult process, a difficult decision. I don't want to move the urban service boundary any more than anyone else does. I think there's an awful lot of infill, and I'd love to hear someone tell me or give me a report or show me a report that tells me how much infill is available now before we even have to start talking about moving the urban service boundary. Although, again, I have to say the Kiplinger Project is a very interesting concept, which won't develop for probably 20 years.
Right, right. Yeah. It's the Pineland Prairie.
Pineland
again,
Prairie,
if folks are looking that up. And the other one down in Hope, Harmony Sound over by Hope Grove, that one is going to be, it's more than 50% of its area, almost 1,500 acres would be permanent open space. I spoke with Mr. Tom Kenny, the VP of the development. So they're very interesting projects that are actually going to be hot topics for certain, but they're also trying to fit in with the community by developing them in a way there where there is that open space and green space. So fun things to look forward to, should you be elected. What about septic to sewer conversion? Where do you favor or oppose that?
Well, I am such a proponent of septic to sewer. You know, I mean, I believe that we should be even finding better ways of funding these things for folks to make it cheaper for them, because it is creating an environmental impact undoubtedly along our waterways. And I just think we need to do something to help to be able to fund that. If there's anything that we could possibly do to work through that, I would certainly be very supportive. I think a managed waste system is certainly much better than uncontrolled water extraction from our aquifers and septic systems.
I agree, and I'm glad to hear that very much. One thing that the commission has done in the past is they hire a lot of consultants. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that? Is that always a good thing? There's been a lot of money spent. I think that's where the taxpayers might have said a little bit of a no to that last sales tax.
I believe that, you know, there's undoubtedly a need for consultant work. There is. You know, I mean, I don't think the staff has the ability, the time, or sometimes the resources to do some of these assessments that we have to hire people for. But the reality is, if we pay for a consultant to provide service to us, we have to follow what the consultant says. We have for many, many years, and in far too many projects. Recently, the CBRE project on facilities, where we've gotten a report back and we ignore it. We don't do it. It goes on the shelf and we do nothing with it. And more often times than not, it's because there's a cost associated with it.
Right.
But there's a need cost. There's a need cost right now, you know, for public safety needs. You know, we have fire stations that are in dire need of replacement, fire stations that are in need of expansion. We need a fire training facility that could be shared possibly with the sheriff's folks. We need these are not wants, they're needs. These
right.
are public needs for our public safety folks, and we have to be able to provide those things. So,
and as we're talking as well, talking about building and permitting and this kind of thing, that is a common complaint among business owners and developers renovating, is the permit process is so tedious and cumbersome.
Isn't that the truth?
It is.
I will tell you that as the general service director, we had to follow those same rules.
Okay.
So understand that when I hear people, and I do hear it all the time on the campaign trail from folks that are trying to get permits in, and what takes so long, how come it takes so long, I say, I know. I had to do the same thing. Sometimes I'd wait for months, and it'd get lost in the system. And I knew the system. I was
right.
in the system, so I could actually find and track it down and talk to people and finally get it uncovered. I can't imagine what it must be like for the public. And I hear it all the time, and now we're going through a new transition into a new software, so I know there's a struggle that's going on in the building department and engineering and growth management. I think once that happens, it should settle. I know they've added some more staff to help in that process, but there's another piece of this puzzle that has to be faced, and the reality that staff has to be better coached at what they're there for. They're there to provide service to the public. We're supposed to be helping people through these cumbersome processes, not strangling them through the processes.
Right.
And some of that has happened through the years because of fear. You know, sometimes fear, you know, the pro-no-growth factions on both sides has caused a real challenge to employees in the county, the staff. They're afraid sometimes to make decisions, the right decisions
right.
even so, but they're afraid they'll get chewed out, or they'll get, you know, pulled up on the carpet in front of people in the public. So that has to be settled, and I think we have to do a better job, again, of coaching folks to get them to understand why they're here. They're here to provide service to the public and help them through a process, not hinder them. So,
Harold Markey, candidate for District 4 County Commission here in Martin County. We're running out of time. We've got about a minute and a half. And first of all, do you have a Facebook page?
I do.
You do. Harold Markey for District 4, right?
Yeah.
And a website?
I do have a website, too.
And that is?
VoteForMarkey.com.
VoteForMarkey.com. And do you
four,
have?
Four with a four.
Four, yeah. Number four. And do you have any meet and greets coming up that you wanted to let us know about?
I do. This Wednesday, the 25th, down at Harry and the Natives. We have a meet and greet from 5:30 to 7:30.
Wonderful. Wonderful place in Hope Sound. And finally, we talked about pro-growth and no-growth. Where do you put yourself on that scale?
Smart growth. I'm right in the middle. You know, I don't think we can continue to say no and survive economically, and I think we have to support our economic growth, business growth, not undoubtedly. And I don't believe in sprawl either, you know, at all. So I don't believe in just opening the gates and letting it flood. So I think there's a place for smart growth, reasonable growth, compromise, you know, and common sense.
Absolutely. Harold Markey, it's been a pleasure to have you in the studio. We currently have two Eds on the County Commission, and Harold Markey's trying to make two Harolds on the County Commission. So that would be a lot of fun. Again, running for District 4. County Commission, and you can meet Harold next Wednesday at Harry the Natives, 5:30 to 7:30. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Casey.